The topic of our sharing today is going to be on lifelong praises or lifelong praise. Now, why did I pick that topic? I picked it because we're in the season of worship now, and God put it on my heart to share each one of us to focus on what the main thing is. So as Gary and the worship team were leading us into worship, I wanted us to really bring this back into the purpose of why we worship God. See, we are created to be worshipers. That's all that humankind was created for. And if we don't do that part, then it's very possible that our role that is yet to come, when we get there, we will be surprised that, oh, God, you created us to be worshipers, but yet on this life that we are called sojourners, we're not doing that. So as you can see up there, it says lifelong worship. Now let's see if I can do this right. Okay. I gotta put this into. I'm sure we all know what Facebook. I'm a master of Facebook. I know what that master. Let me step back. I'm not a master of Facebook, but I know how to use Facebook. I don't know much about Snapchat, but I know what Snapchat does. I tweet, not enough as Donald Trump, but I try to tweet when I can. So, see, if you look around, except in our Mabusa Sports Ministry meeting, we made that it's okay, because we use this app where everyone gets to look at their phone. So it legitimizes the usage of mobile devices. But everywhere, even at home, or even everywhere, even I've been looking for my girls. I'm going to put my girls, not the boys, girls on blast again. I've been looking for Vanessa and Chelsea. Where are they? Elder would be like, Vanessa, Chelsea. And I don't know why these screens are so small, but they're like looking in it. And they just spend so much time on this thing. We don't know if they spend it on Facebook or they're watching a movie or whatnot. But see, this is the life that the world is going into. We spend so much time on these things that it takes away the place of our worship. Now imagine that. If God created you and I to worship Him, and whatever that we do, we like think, okay, God. But He said we're like Facebook, Snapchat, tweeting. But we're so like tied up with these things that takes up our minds. I mean, would you agree? Maybe the pre-millennials will not agree, but the millennials will agree. Or the next generation or my generation would agree. But I am late to it because when I'm home, I'm either studying or I'm Facebooking. So I'm not saying this to like make you the bad people and I'm the good guys. No, I'm really part of the problem. But we try to, like, in our Bible study on Tuesday evenings and Wednesday evenings, we try to tell them, you know, there's so much stuff in the cloud, in the air, but why can't we use the Word of God to be the one that predominate all of these things that are on Facebook or in the air? So, you guys heard of the theory of evolution, right? People came from A, they kind of worked their way up, and now, whatever they do, it's either you're Facebook something, or you're Twitter something, or you're a Snapchat master. You know, this is what the world is. Even though we think like, well, we're Christians, we don't believe in theory of evolution. But this is what attitude. I don't know what the next thing is going to be. Is it going to be Facebook still for how many years? We don't know. But I have been in right now, this season right now, if you talk to any Kosraeans, except me, but all the other Kosraeans, if you talk to them, like, what's your plan for this season? Everyone are trying to get to Kosrae right now. Because traditionally, every 4 years, Kosraeans will come together and work to do their marching, their celebration. So, I put up a picture of my mom and my dad. My sister put up pictures of her getting ready to go. And I see the excitement in her eyes. She is so excited that she gets to go. I don't know how many years she has been home. She is so excited. She's preparing stuff and getting at the airport. She's sitting there. And I look in the eyes of my dad. My dad is like, I don't know what's going on. My dad is not in the program. His mind is still remembering things, but there are other things that are in his mind, but right now my mom is so excited being Kosrae. I told her, my mom is part of the church, Kosrae Congregational Church leaders. So I told her, you know, Mom, you being a leader, if you see things that are not in line with God's word, if you don't say anything about it, to use the scripture to rebuke it, God will curse you. And I boldly told her, I go, you know what? God cannot curse me because of your action. Because I have decided to accept Christ as my personal Lord and Savior. I've accepted Christ, a lot of blood of Christ, to break all the sins, all the history, all my connections, the history from generation to generation to generation, 3 or 4 generations. I've asked Christ for my life. So whatever that you do, will not affect me. Does that make sense? But it will affect my brothers, or my sister, or your cousins, or our relatives, if you're not careful about that. That's what leads me into this message today. Message today, there are 2 points that I want to share with you. And it is, praise the Lord, and trust the Lord. See, what we're doing as a people, we oftentimes just talk about it, but we don't necessarily live it. So, before it is very appropriate, every time we go into scripture to talk about the scripture, join me as we pray. Shall we pray? So we thank you, Lord, we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. So, we're going to be in Psalm chapter 4, Psalm 146. There's only four verses, which means that my message is going to be really short today. So Psalm 146. Praise the Lord, my soul. I will praise the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. Do not put your trust in princes. Or prince, in human beings who cannot save. When their spirit departs, they return to the ground. On that very day, their plans come to nothing. So I wanted to talk to you about this. I wanted to make sure that we understand this word, hallelujah. Hallelujah comes from, it's two words. One is Hallel, and the other one is Vehur, Yahweh. Hallel is to give praises. Something that truly put your heart into it. Praise to who? To God, to Yahweh. Yahweh doesn't, we don't understand Yahweh until Exodus chapter 3, verse 14 and 15. But before Yahweh, God came to Abraham and he told that, I am the God Almighty. I am the El Shaddai. But he didn't tell Abraham his name. But in this case, he came to Moses, and Moses asked him, who should I tell them that sent me? And he said, I am that I am. Tell them that I am that I am that sent you. And that is Yahweh. That is the God that you and I worship. Some people say it's God the Son, God the Father, but we're not going to go there. We're not going to go there yet, but let's understand that it is God, Yahweh. Yahweh, this is what you say, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. See the Lord, that's all. So when we sing the hallelujah, remember that we are singing praises to him, the God Almighty. God said to Moses, tell them that I am who I am, and this is what you are to say, that I am sent you. So I am who I am that sent you. So God the Father, I am, and God the Son, I am, sent you. So this is the worship that we have to do. We have to make sure that we give our praises to God. Now, if you notice that the beginning of Psalms, the book of Psalms has 150 chapters in it. Now, it's broken into five different sections. And if you look at it, those five different sections, they're going to be parallel to the Pentateuch, the five first book of the Bible. So we're going to stay in the last section, which starts with worship. Now, the end of this chapter here, or first chapter 104, verse 10, or verse 35 says that they start with praise the Lord, and then first 10 of this chapter, and the rest of the chapters from verse 46 all the way to 50, it begins with praise the Lord and ends with praise the Lord. So if you think about Psalm, what is this book of Psalm? And what are the other 55 books? Because of the time, we're talking about book of Proverbs and Psalm. It's Psalm and Proverbs. As I shared before, that book of Psalm, it tells you a little bit of the characteristics of who God is. If you understand, if you read Psalm, it'll give you an idea who God is. And then you go to the book of Proverbs. Proverbs will show you how you relate with one another. And if you think about it, there are 150 chapters written in the book of Psalm to talk about who God is. But there are only 31 chapters for us to understand how are we to live among each other. All right, thank you, Zach. I guess I'm playing a bit. Anyways, what I'm saying here is, when we do our worship, we have to really make sure that our form of worship is accepted. Now, you know that worship is not just singing up here. Worship is not just worship is everything, including your gift, what is time for offering. Do you worship God with what God has blessed you with? Think about that. Do we give God what he deserves? We don't just sing worship. Yes, true, we do that. But we have to do a lot more. We got to don't just think what is convenient for you. Or I don't just think, talk about what's convenient for me. We have to make sure that when we worship, we do the whole nine yards. We praise him, we obey the Bible, we talk to him, and when it's time to give, this is how we understand, this is how we tell God that, Lord God, I am so attached to my money. My money is what I live with. But you know what? Because I praise you and I worship you, I'm going to give you not all of it, but you only ask for a tenth to begin with. As a way to gauge how much I can trust in you, which we're going to be talking about in the next point. But the first point here is just for us to understand. This song that we're talking about is written by King David. Now, question is, who is King David and what are some of his accomplishments? So if we look at King David and we look at Samuel, first 13, chapter 13, verse 34, God told Samuel that I have already chosen one man who I called him a man after my own heart. God Yahweh, God the Father, God the higher, the God who is bigger than everything else. He picked a man and he called that man a man after his own heart. And that's who King David is to you and me. King David, even though God called him as a man after his own heart, he wanted to build a temple. He wanted to build a temple that will house what's called a tabernacle, this tent, this holy tent. He thought he was good enough to build a temple. And God says, no, even though you have to, you're a man that I chose to lose after my own heart, but your hands are dirty. Your hands are filthy. You have killed people. You have blood in your hands. Therefore, I am going to, I've already picked somebody who is to build my temple. And we know that it's King Solomon. And when we give praises, we have to be intentional. I know sometimes we show up in church and we come to church with a lot of our own ideas, with our problems and things like that. And we don't want to worship. We don't want to give praises to Him. So that's what I mean by we have to be intentional. We have to come in and know that there is that God who is present. There is that presence of God that I have to be intentional in giving Him praises. And this God that you and I have, He's a God who is faithful. He's a God who is gracious. You guys know what faithful and what gracious is? You know, if you think about this word grace, it's something that you get because you didn't do anything. You have no parts in it. And God is gracious not only to those who are disobedient, but those who are in need of wherever they are. God will bring us down to a place where we are so helpless that we cannot rely on anything else. But He's waiting because He wants to know that whatever else that you're going through in life, whatever else that I can rely on, whatever else you might think that I can rely on by saving, so it's okay, I will not be doing my tithing, I will not be doing my worship, form of worship, which is offering. God will drain your bank, and He will make you know that, you know, if it wasn't for me, you will not have that. That way you and I can almost come, when we get to it, we will know that everything that we are relying upon does not work. And only He can provide that. That's an awesome thing. That's an awesome thing. We don't need to go there. But if we, because of our disobedience, God will bring us to the bottomless part of the bottom of the bottom where we know that, where He would want us to know that there are no other options but Him. Trust in the Lord, verse 3-4. Trust in the Lord, do not put your trust in man. Do not put your trust in human being who cannot say, when their spirit departs, they return to ground, and on that day, and on that very day, their plans will come to nothing. So, as God's people, we are to put our trust in who? In the only one. And if you notice up there that one is capitalized. That means there is the only one that we have to put our trust in. We cannot put our trust in anything else because according to Psalm 104 and Ecclesiastes, Psalm 104 says that when you take away their bread, they die and return to dust. And then Ecclesiastes, it says here that all go to the same place, all come from dust, and to dust all returns. So what I'm saying here is that this is how I think as humanly speaking. I would prefer to impress upon people, because people are the ones who can lift me up, are the ones who can bring me encouragement, and I don't want to disappoint them or upset them, because if I do upset them, then I will become very lonely. Therefore, I like to compromise. I like to compromise, and it's okay, this is what the Word of God says, but God knows my heart. He will understand. But see, if you're sad, you know that I am going down a very wrong path. If I compromise the Word of God in order to impress upon people. As believers, as Christians, we have to stand tall and walk that fine path. And our life has to reflect who God is. And whatever else that we do in life, we shouldn't compromise the Word of God. We shouldn't compromise the Word of God. We shouldn't compromise anything for man, because when people die, so has their plans. But see, if you look at the Bible, this whole 66 books, and if you look at all the prophets that God uses to deliver his message to the Israelites, if you look at those people, we would not have studied their names. We would not have heard their names had they not followed the Word of God. Now, if we would not be studying about Zechariah, the father of John, Elizabeth, the mother of John, Mary, we would not be talking about these people thousands and thousands of years after. But it is because of their obedience to God Almighty. I believe that that's the reason why you and I are here talking about this. But we're not talking about this man, but we're talking about what God had done in their lives. The one who trusts in men has no reasons for praising. A person who trusts in what men can do is, in a very disrespectful, a very common way of saying, a person who is full of himself doesn't worship God. Because he would come in and go, "Question, worship this God." A person who is full of himself do not or does not worship God, because he thinks that he's God. And if you look at Matthew 6:19, it says that do not store up for yourself treasures on earth where moth and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. Like I said, as people, oftentimes we spend so much time into the things, the material things, and something can happen and just take everything away. But the Word of God, if we know that the Word of God remains, it's been, the Word of God is there 2,000 years ago, and it still exists today. So when we talk about worship, when we talk about giving praise to God, I'll share with you a very short story and a very true story too. There is a man that was very faithful to God, or is faithful to God, or was faithful to God. And he always tried to do what he can. When he served God, he goes and he does what he's supposed to do. When it comes to giving, he gives God everything. And then he one day decided to just kind of test God. He decided to go, "Well, you know what? My givings, I think I should do something. I should pay bills with this things. This giving that I do, that this person would normally give. As part of offering, as part of tithing." And when he did that, first week was okay. First paycheck, he reported that it was okay. He was able to live until his next paycheck, nothing happens. And then second paycheck came, he didn't do it either, so he kind of tested. He felt a little bit of conviction of not doing that. And then the third time around, where unforeseen expenses, accidents, things like his whole business came up, like took away everything that he thought that he had. So the moral of the story is that when we're faithful to God, there has to be consistency. Because Satan knows what we're up against. And Satan knows that when we obey the word of God, promises of God will fall upon those who are in obedience with the word of God. That's a promise that God gave us as his believers. And Satan knows that if we're testing the water, he will burn us immediately. He wants us to kind of like slowly get into it until we are so deep into it that the next thing he does is he starts stealing what we have. Not only stealing, but he destroys them. He destroys them, and then the last thing is it's annihilation. It's destruction. It's life is lost because of what. This is how Satan works. And I always want to ask you a question like, why is it that you and I rely so much on people, on someone, on things other than God? But when we're in deep need, what is it the first thing we do? We go and pray. Why is it? Have you ever thought about this? That we don't truly do things of God let's say I spend 48 hours a week at work, and maybe spend like 2 hours a week studying the word of God. But then when something happens to me or my family, I don't run to my employer and go, Mr. Employer, can you help me with this? I go before God on my knees and I ask God to help me. Now think about that. But most of our part, see, God understands this. God, it's not really what you put on the outside, but it is what's inside of our heart that matters. So the challenge I want to post upon you is when we do things, why is it that it's our last resort, and then we go to God? Why is it that we invest so much time in things of the world, yet when it comes to urgent issues, where do we go? These are things that I just wanted to also just challenge you with, kind of poke you a little bit, get you a little bit uncomfortable. If you're comfortable, that's good. Because the word of God is to come and convict us with the things that we do. But it is not to condemn us. I am not trying to stand up here and tell you that you're bad, you're bad people. I'm only saying that the word of God, when it comes to us, it comes to us because it is to give us strength. It's like we're sheep, right? We're sheep. It's like a shepherd who's like, we use the staff and like tap us. It doesn't spank us, but it taps us so we can walk that fine path or straight path so we can get to our destination and not having to go around the world different directions before we end up. Not for us like the Israelites. A trip that should have taken 3 to 7 days took 40 years. Because that's how long it would take for them to get that mental change. And that it is no different to you and me. If we don't make that mental change in putting God first, in our praise and our worship, God loves us. John 3:16, everyone knows that. God loves us. God only loves us. He so loved us. That is, he loved us first. In the book of Visions, it says that before the beginning of creation, God has already had plans for us to be seated with Christ, the Son of God. We have already been inherited into his kingdom. That's his plan. And that's his plan of this act of redemption. Act of redemption is God's way of bringing back his people to him, because he sent his only begotten son, the only one son he had, the only begotten. It wasn't just a Son, but be God, something that he was attached to, something that his mind was in it. His begotten Son, he sent it just so we can have eternal life. We will be perished. That's what the salvation is. This act of his redemption is to bring salvation, to bring salvation to him, and every one of us will be redeemed. And you maybe are redeemed. But see, notice that King David says, the Psalm says that Jesus Christ is seated at the right hand of God the Father. He's seated. He did his part. He came and he died on the cross. He's died. He's seated. He's seated. And what does he do? He's seated and intercedes for you and me. Knowing that what you and me are doing on this earth is to do the Great Commission, to go preach, go teach, go disciple, and to baptize in the name of God, the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost. And this is what we're commissioned to do. And that's what this love of God that he gives to mankind, and that's everyone. So each one of us here has a purpose. And that purpose is to extend the grace of God. You maybe have it. You already have received salvation, but you're not done. We're still here. We're still here because God is still using us for something. And when we do it, when we serve God, we give it our best. We don't just do it kind of half-heartedly. But we give it our best. So that's what I wanted to close with. Just to kind of poke you a little bit as we're stepping into the holiday season. So I'll pray and then Gary can, I'll turn it over to Gary and Brother Seto. So please join me as we pray. I know that it wasn't last that you were here, but whatever that you heard, it meant for you. And God meant it for you. And we'll pray and ask God that God can use that as you continue moving forward. So shall we pray? Lord, we thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your word. Thank you for everyone who's present here, Lord. Lord, we ask because we need you to help us. We need you to intervene in our lives, Lord God. That as we serve you, Lord, things that we didn't understand, we ask that you open our eyes to see. Father God, we cannot do anything without you, so we ask for the presence of the Holy Spirit to work, to take residence over our lives, the things that we do, that we become closer to you.